there is more to reality than meets a normal eye. Behind the curtain of everyday consciousness is hidden another unutterably strange mental universe. It's the realm of mystical experience, and those who've been there describe the visit as the most significant event of their lives. Until recent times, it was a world known only to holy men, to saints, and perhaps to the insane. Then, a generation ago, this drug, LSD, escaped from the laboratory and was consumed by millions of young people. To some, it's a doorway to the mystical universe, chemical ecstasy, enlightenment in a bottle. To others, it's a dangerous and subversive poison. The drug challenges our very conception of reality, and its turbulent history raises sharp questions about the dividing line between private experience and public policy.
It would benefit most of all professors. I think it would be extremely good for almost anybody with fixed ideas and with a great certainty about what's what to take this thing.
LSD is the most dangerous drug that we have in the world today.
Acid is good for kids.
Go. If you can reach a firm verdict about the right to use this fascinating, beneficent, but dangerous drug for purely personal experience, I envy you.
The remarkable effects of LSD were discovered by accident in Switzerland during the Second World War. Albert Hofmann was then a young chemist working in the laboratories of Sandoz, a large pharmaceutical company.
The program I was involved was to study the active principles of medicinal plants. And one of these medicinal plants we were studying was ergot.
Ergot is a fungus that grows on corn. For centuries, midwives have used it to stimulate the uterus in childbirth. At Sandoz, Hofmann was experimenting with ergot, trying to refine its effect. On the 16th of April, 1943, he was in his laboratory preparing a fresh batch of a compound he'd first synthesized 5 years before. It was lysergic acid diethylamide, LSD.
At the end of the synthesis, I got in a very strange psychic situation. A kind of dream world appeared, a feeling of oneness with the world, a very strange experience which reminded me to some experience I had in childhood. Sometimes when I was in nature, in the forest, in the wood, that I had some kind of, I would say, mystical experiences. The feeling of oneness, to be one with nature, the feeling to see now the true aspects of nature, the beauty, and which filled me with happiness.
Could it be that this pleasant, dreamlike state was in some way connected with the crystals of LSD that Albert Hofmann was purifying that afternoon? He'd certainly not eaten any, but his fingers might possibly have brushed against a few traces of the compound. If so, then LSD was a remarkably potent drug. He decided to experiment on himself.
Being a cautious man, I thought I would start with the smallest quantity, which even it could have any effect. Namely, I started with 0.25 milligram and had the intention then to to increase the dosage, but then to see if something would happen. But this very small dose, the first dose of my experiments I planned, was very, very strong.
Feeling increasingly unwell, Hoffman was obliged to return home. It was wartime. He went by bicycle. As the journey progressed, the external world began to look stranger and stranger. By the time he reached home, normal reality had disintegrated.
When I entered this room, I was really astonished how this room had changed. The room itself and the objects in this room had quite a different form, different color, different meaning. The objects, like this chair, was like he was a living object. It became moving from inside. Was so unusual that I really got afraid that I had become insane.
A kind next-door neighbor brought milk as an antidote.
Ich bring Ihnen ein Gläschen Milch, Herr Doktor.
She too was malevolently transformed. The bizarre and terrifying hallucinations continued all evening. At times, Hoffman felt that he was dead and had arrived in hell. But at last, 6 hours after taking the drug, he felt himself returning to the normal world. 2 days later, now fully recovered, Hoffman reported his discovery to the head of the laboratory. 1 teaspoon of this new drug, LSD, could render 50,000 people temporarily insane.
I myself, and also, of course, the medical department realized immediately that was a very important agent which could be useful in psychiatry and in research.
Sandoz distributed LSD to psychiatric hospitals as an experimental drug called Delicid. No one really knew what medical use LSD might have, but this extraordinary substance deserved further study. Research soon showed that LSD closely resembles powerful natural chemicals in the brain, used to exchange messages between nerve cells. The drug acts like a false signal, disrupting the normal flow of information. One specific effect is to disable the region of the brain that filters information arriving from the senses. A flood of signals reaches consciousness and is experienced as an overwhelming deluge of sensation. The impact on the mind is profound. It's as if reality were suddenly uncensored, revealing a world exquisitely or horrifically transformed. All the senses are affected. Colors particularly are brighter and more vivid. Sound, too, is strangely transformed. Sights are smelt and sounds are seen. motion becomes a web of frozen moments. And often the world is strewn with bizarre distortions of reality. Hallucinations and pretty colors are only part of the story. LSD also affects the subconscious mind. In the early 1950s, psychiatrists began to investigate this aspect of the drug. All over the world, scientific papers appeared reporting the use of LSD in the treatment of psychiatric patients. The leading center was Powick Hospital in England. Here, in a purpose-built facility known as the LSD Block, hundreds of mentally ill people were treated with LSD. The consultant psychiatrist who pioneered this work was Ronald Sanderson. For a decade, he ran the Powick unit. Today, the LSD block has been converted into offices. Dr. Sanderson returns there to recall the past.
This is where we worked 30 years ago?
Yes, I didn't quite remember it as being this sort of shape. I remember something a different entrance from the corridor.
Ah, yes.
With him is Dr. John Whitelaw, a colleague from the LSD days.
This, remember, was the trolley area where the nursing staff used to set up the LSD ampoules, and they draw the LSD ampoule syringe, and, you know, we had little medicine bottles they poured it into, and the still bottle was added to it. And they just used to stand where you are and pick the stuff. Most people noticed that the first effects came on after about 20 minutes, and somewhere in the first hour they would retire to their own particular room which had been allocated to them. And looked at from the outside, you might think there was nothing going on, because LSD doesn't have a marked effect on behaviour. What it affects is in internal mental processes. We used to have a little bed in the
single bed.
The point of giving patients LSD was to release suppressed memories and mental conflicts that psychoanalysts believe are the root cause of mental illness. LSD was perhaps a key to unlock the unconscious mind.
There's a curious kind of artifact in the early stages of LSD that people often have a great tendency to laugh, and that seems to be a sort of side effect. I experienced it myself when I took LSD, and I wasn't quite sure, you know, it wasn't funny, I wasn't laughing at anything, but I just had this thing. So that sort of sets a scene for experiencing greater emotional intensity. But with our patients, there was very often a great deal of fear, a great deal of crying, sobbing, and then, of course, one would want to move in and try and get the patient to relate that to what they're actually experiencing in themselves.
Given the reputation LSD has today, it's natural to wonder whether any patients were harmed by the drug.
We don't believe that anybody had a long-term psychosis. I know that cases have been reported from other parts of the world, but we examined our consciences pretty carefully in that respect, and I don't believe anybody was permanently damaged.
Extraordinary as it now seems, thousands of people were given LSD in psychiatric hospitals during the 50s. According to several independent studies, there were surprisingly few bad side effects. And a second group began to experiment with hallucinogenic drugs around this time. They were artists and intellectuals, and their inspiration came from the British writer Aldous Huxley. Huxley was fascinated by mystical experience and believed that a drug called mescaline might be a means to achieve it. Mescaline is found in a cactus called peyote, used by the Huichol Indians of Mexico. They regard peyote as sacred, and they've consumed it in religious ceremonies for centuries. objectively, the effects of mescaline are identical to those of LSD. The drug precipitates a charged and overwhelming journey of the soul. In 1953, Aldous Huxley sent an invitation to a British psychiatrist who had suggested a link between the effects of mescaline and the symptoms of schizophrenia.
He'd asked me down there for many reasons, but one of them was that he hoped that I'd give him mescaline. He'd been cleared by his doctor. This seemed to be one way out on my part. I was disconcerted that he'd bought a grey autograph, and so I had no way out, really. And so as I, on the second last day of my visit, I stood stirring in the mescaline, which has a strange oily swirl, and I wondered if I would be remembered as a man who'd gone to California and driven Aldous Huxley mad. I thought it would be really rather invidious reputation.
Thus it came about one bright May morning. I swallowed 4/10 of a gram of mescaline dissolved in half a glass of water, and sat down to wait for the results. After a while, I became aware of a slow dance of golden lights. I was looking intently at a small vase of flowers. My eyes traveled from the rose to the carnation, and to the smooth scrolls of sentient amethyst, which was the iris. I was seeing,
be used in interrogation of prisoners or something,
the religious experience of student priests.
And you could look at any